Harvest and Harper Audio present For the Culture, Phenomenal Black Women and Femmes in Food, Interviews, Inspiration, and Recipes by Klancy Miller. Read by Klancy Miller, Ariel Blake, Karen Malina White, Susan Dalian, Janina Edwards, Machelle Williams, and Sisi Johnson. A note before we begin, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. It contains recipes from the book. This book is dedicated to my parents, Rose and Isaac Miller, for introducing me to good food, the meaning of hospitality, and for supporting me on my journey. This book is also dedicated to all Black women and femmes who steward the land, feed us, and bring us together with food and wine. Introduction. When I graduated from college, I had no idea what I wanted to do, but I was curious about food, having been raised by two restaurant lovers and avid cooks. I got a job in a nonprofit, set aside time to explore my other interests, filmmaking, acting, cooking, and began apprenticing at Fork Restaurant in Philadelphia on the weekends to try to figure out what kind of work I'd be passionate about. Amped up by my restaurant gig, I decided to go to culinary school in Paris to become a pastry chef. At the time, I didn't know about the many options available under the big umbrella of food and hospitality. Over the course of several years, I would try on different roles, from baker to supper club host to restaurant publicist to ghostwriter to cookbook author. I didn't have a ton of information to guide me, but it didn't have to be that way. Looking back, I wish I'd had more sisterly insights to accompany me on my path. I didn't have this when I was coming up, so I'm giving it to you now, with the hope that it'll help guide future generations that are beginning their paths in the food and hospitality space. I founded the magazine For the Culture because Black women have shaped cuisine in the United States and in many countries, and our stories about our expertise in food do not receive enough attention or admiration. The goal was to create a publication that centers the narratives of Black women and femmes in food and hospitality. My intention in creating this book is similar, though with a slightly different motivation. I wanted to make it for my 21-year-old self, a person interested in food, but completely unaware of all the ways to participate in this space, and equally unaware of Black women and femmes, past and present, doing phenomenal and awe-inspiring work in food, wine, and hospitality. I wanted to ask the questions that a beginner might ask. How did you begin? I also wanted to ask questions about things I am still learning about. How do you build a team? How do you negotiate compensation? How do you build community? How do you take care of your mental health? What you'll find in this book are interviews with 66 women and femmes about their careers in food and their lives in general, recipes contributed by the interviewees, and profiles of our culinary matriarch ancestors, the women on whose shoulders we stand and who serve as a collective North Star. My feeling is that if you know and care about Julia Child, you should be equally familiar with Edna Lewis, B. Smith, Lena Richard, Verda Mae Smart Grosvenor, and Leah Chase. The women and femmes in this book are some of the most generous, brilliant, inquisitive, transparent, hilarious, adventurous, and hardworking people I have encountered. They carry on a rich, sacred tradition that Black women have been at the center of, stewarding the land, educating people about what they cook or imbibe, cooking meals that bring people together and allow our humanity and love to be shared. I hope you will be inspired and energized by their stories and the gems of wisdom they share. Note, The interviews in this book have been edited and condensed for clarity. Reflections: The Women on Whose Shoulders We Stand. Edna Lewis. Born April 13, 1916. Died February 13, 2006. When I read The Taste of Country Cooking, I was quite taken by Lewis's emphasis on community, her focus on seasonality, and the personal lens through which she wrote. I saw myself in her. We both came from loving, strong Black communities in the South. We both moved to New York City to cultivate our careers, and we both had immense pride in our Blackness. Bryant Terry, chef, educator, author, editor-in-chief of Four Color Books, from Illustrated Black History, Honoring the Iconic and the Unseen, by George McCallman. Edna Lewis proved that by preserving your own culture, you could shape culture. Her life and work illustrate the power of valuing your own heritage, not taking it for granted, but centering and celebrating what's in your backyard and mastering the skills involved in cooking what is, as she said, the only true American cuisine. Lewis was born in Freetown, Virginia. In The Taste of Country Cooking, she describes it as a community of farming people. It wasn't really a town. The name was adopted because the first residents had all been freed from chattel slavery, and they wanted to be known as free people. Lewis, the grandchild of Chester and Lucinda Lewis, who were among the founders of Freetown, learned from this community everything about cooking, gardening, foraging, and farming that would lead to the foundation of her career. As a teenager, she left Virginia and moved first to Washington, D.C., where she cooked at the Brazilian embassy, and then to New York. There, she worked domestic jobs and became a seamstress whose dresses were in demand by people such as Marilyn Monroe. She also dressed windows at Bonwit Teller, the luxury women's store. Lewis married Steve Kingston, a merchant mariner and communist. She worked in the office of the communist newspaper, The Daily Worker. She was a multi-hyphenate decades before the term was in vogue. In 1948, she became chef at her friend Johnny Nicholson's Cafe Nicholson on Manhattan's East Side. She cooked elegant home-style dishes such as roast chicken, cheese soufflé, green salads, biscuits, and chocolate soufflé. Her food made the restaurant a success and attracted celebrities such as Paul Robeson, Marlon Brando, Salvador Dali, Eleanor Roosevelt, Truman Capote, Tennessee Williams, and William Faulkner. Following her exit from the cafe in 1954, she became a pheasant farmer, opened a restaurant in Harlem that was in business only briefly, taught culinary classes, catered, and was a lecturer at the American Museum of Natural History. Her first cookbook, The Edna Lewis Cookbook, was published in 1972. That was the same year she met the renowned editor Judith Jones, who would become the editor for Lewis's most well-known book, The Taste of Country Cooking. Both a memoir of her early years in Freetown and a story of the food she and her family cooked and ate during each season, The Taste of Country Cooking is her most iconic book. She also wrote two others, In Pursuit of Flavor and The Gift of Southern Cooking, which was co-authored with her friend and protege, Scott Peacock. At the age of 72, Edna Lewis became the chef at Gage & Tolner, which at the time was the oldest continuously open restaurant in New York City, having been founded in 1879. Her menu included breaded and butter-fried Ipswich clams, creamy she-crab soup, and catfish stew with scallions and garlic. In 2006, cultural columnist Jeff Weinstein wrote in the Philadelphia Inquirer, "I was certain that Edna Lewis's Gage and Tolner was the best place to eat in New York. Lewis left the restaurant in 1992 at the age of 76 and moved to Atlanta, where she taught cooking and started the Society for the Revival and Preservation of Southern Food. Among the honors she received in her lifetime, being named Grand Dame of Les Dames d'Escoffier International, receiving an honorary PhD in culinary arts from Johnson and Wales University, and being inducted into the James Beard Foundation Cookbook Hall of Fame. She was also honored posthumously with a commemorative United States postage stamp. Edna Lewis died in 2006 at the age of 89. Her life and body of work continue to be a North Star for many people in food and hospitality and beyond. In Edna Lewis, At the Table with an American Original, Mashama Bailey encapsulates what countless people feel about Ms. Lewis. Edna Lewis's search for taste, as well as her story, stuck with me. A Black woman from the South, Miss Lewis moved to New York to start a whole new life, first as a laundress, later as a seamstress and restaurant chef. She was never formally trained, but she had grown up cooking in rural Virginia, was hardworking, and loved wholesome food made with fresh ingredients. This sounded like many women in my family before me. As the opening chef at Cafe Nicholson in New York in the 1950s, she showcased simple food and was heaped with praise for it. Through Miss Lewis, I realized that there was a history of Black women like me in professional kitchens and that I wasn't alone. Barbara Elaine Smith, B. Smith. Born August 24, 1949, died February 22, 2020. When you watched her show, she just commanded the camera, not only because she was beautiful, but just because she was so elegant and poised and seemed naturally just meant to be in this gorgeous home in the Hamptons and hosting people. You felt like you were a guest in her home. That inspires me as a woman, and as a Black woman in particular. You can enter those spaces with grace and poise because you were meant to be there, and no one can ever make you feel like you don't deserve to be where you're at. Korsha Wilson, writer and host of A Hungry Society podcast. The day I graduated from college, my family and I went to eat at B. Smith's restaurant in Manhattan's Theater District to celebrate. It was incredibly exciting to me because I saw B. Smith as a role model, actress, model, singer, television personality, author, magazine editor, cook, restaurateur, and tastemaker. She was a person who exemplified possibilities in a field I found intriguing. Even though I wasn't entirely sure what I wanted to do next, I felt inspired by all she had accomplished. Eating at her restaurant made me feel like maybe I too could create something beautiful and take up space in the world of food and hospitality. Born in Everson, Pennsylvania, Smith learned to cook from her mother, Florence Claybrook Smith, and her maternal grandmother, Hart Claybrook. Smith's mother was a part-time housekeeper, and her father was a steelworker. In her books, she describes her childhood as being filled with numerous family gatherings, always supplied with abundant amounts of food, vegetables from their garden, and fruit from their trees. Her mother, grandmother, and aunts cooked often, and her father made homemade wine and root beer for these gatherings. As a child, Smith was interested in sewing and cooking, but felt rebuffed at the local 4-H club, a youth development organization. So she created her own home economics club and became its president. Smith began modeling after finishing high school. In 1969, she won a place in the Ebony Fashion Fair. She later signed with the modeling agency Wilhelmina in New York City and was on the cover of magazines such as Mademoiselle, Ebony, and Essence, In her book, B. Smith's Entertaining and Cooking for Friends, she wrote, "Helping to create fantasies is one of the reasons I became a fashion model. That and the opportunity to travel. My modeling career took me all over the world, and I loved to sample the food wherever I went. When my modeling career was over, it seemed natural to open a restaurant that would offer the different kinds of food I loved and that would provide a gathering place for the rich variety of people I enjoyed meeting." Smith opened her first restaurant in Manhattan in 1986. She later opened restaurants in Sag Harbor, New York, and in Washington, D.C.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.